talk about like three case studies which we were involved in. So, and probably give you a little bit of a mix of different things. But I think Aloka nicely covered all of the different situations that 505B2 can support. So this is a non-ionic iodinated contrast agent, and the challenge for this was establishing drug quality compatibility with the listed drug. So carving out a part of the originator's indications to limit to oral-only indication. Summarization of existing non-clinical and clinical data and doing a meta-analysis to support no clinical and non-clinical study to support the 505B2 pathway. So we designed a robust comparability plan to demonstrate identity and similarity of the drug substance. And if you have questions on that, I mean, I'll look up. I can obviously expand on that. Developed a strategy to compare proposed oral dosage form with the parenteral dosage form developed by the innovator. So this was an oral versus the innovator was a parenteral. We addressed several critical CMC issues specific to powder dosage forms. And based on extensive literature assessment of non-clinical and clinical, we developed a rationale for carving out the oral-only use. And obviously, we negotiated with the agency for a compelling labeling for this product. And the benefit is we avoided some additional clinical or non-clinical studies for the NDA approval, and that really resulted in huge cost and the resource. And so, you know, so this is a product, and that's sometimes when you start a project like that, you have a certain idea, but you do not have a full picture, and when you look at the data, then you know how to sort of go back to the agency and talk to them. And that's why I think the pre-IND meeting is a very important meeting to go to and have this discussion. And this allows FDA to also think through this more carefully. Yeah.
So this drug did not have an oral dosage form because of the bioavailability issues, and your client basically created an oral dosage form which allowed appropriate bioavailability.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
They didn't have to do clinical trials.
They didn't have to do clinical trials. Correct. Correct.
How did they establish improvement in the bioavailability? What type of data? Like, did they have animal data?
It's very strange because it's an imaging agent as you saw.
It's an imaging agent.
So people were also using the parenteral and they were drinking it, sort of. It's a BCS class 4, so it doesn't get absorbed.
Okay.
So we actually, that was what we jumped on and said, okay, it doesn't get absorbed in the intestinal tract at all, so why not use it as an oral? You know, we knew that it was a off-label being used constantly. So we kind of wrote on that information and the BCS class, we went on fighting on the BCS class and did, you know, some studies. This was unbelievable, actually. Even we could not believe that they eventually bought our argument, but they did.
So the intended use was for as an imaging
no,
agent?
No, it is an imaging agent. It's a parenteral imaging agent.
Is it for like intestinal blockage, that type of thing?
Yeah, to check things like that. So
the intended use was not for absorption in the bloodstream.
No.
It was more like an imaging agent.
It is an imaging agent,
so
but yeah, that is why. But at the same time, if it was not a BCS4, we could not have done this. You know, the whole thing is we jumped on that and said, hey, it doesn't get absorbed in the intestine at all, so you can use it for the same product.
And so, but you had some prior literature.
Yes.
Saying
yes.
That there is
yeah.
No bioavailability.
Oh, yeah.
Issues.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. That's right. Of course. Yeah.
Would you have had the same success if you had tried the aerosol approach? Do you think?
No.
Yeah, probably not.
Because it's the thing that we wrote on here was the bioinavailability of this product.
Okay.
You know.
Yeah. So you have to have some PK study that shows that it was
right.
Not reabsorbed
right.
In animal.
Yes.
That's
yes.
Right.
We wrote on those. I mean, the literature, the amount of literature for this was phenomenal. But at the end of the day, it paid because they went with really technically a CMC and nothing more.
This is another case where I think she was talking about different salt, and this is a different salt with a different counter ion exposure. And here the same thing, we went through the same process of establishing quality comparability with the listed drug, I mean, despite the differences in the salt. And we do have to go through the summarization of existing non-clinical and clinical data and want to make sure that even with a different salt, those data would be applicable. And then we needed to support that no traditional clinical studies needed. And then we did have to do some limited non-clinical studies to support the safety of the counter ion exposure. So those are all of the steps that we did, and there are PK studies obviously within this program, but come up with pretty articulated, compelling labeling for the B2 product, and it did save a lot of time and resources, but we did have to do some of the non-clinical studies to support the application. So. It went through a period of negotiation with the agency and to convince them of the alternate salt. So that was one example, one experience that we had. This is another one. This is a completely a different dosage form. The oral drug is approved. Now you have this is an oral thin film, and we went through the same kind of procedures, with a robust comparability plan to demonstrate identity and similarity of the drug substance. We developed a strategy to compare the proposed oral thin dosage form with the tablet dosage form developed by the innovator. We have to go back to the literature and do an extensive assessment, and also developed a rationale for not needing traditional efficacy study, and then local tolerance information that we needed to collect, both in the clinic and also some non-clinical studies, but at the same time we could still avoid a large efficacy study, so that's a successful, and FDA did come back with some, and they wanted to know a little bit more safety of the product, because this is giving, I mean, I think in the local buccal region, they needed to look at more safety on that. So that was we thought it was a great experience and a successful one. So I just wanted to kind of close this in a way that, and I think, between me and Aloka, and there are other people who are very experienced on the 505B2s, and these are, and there are a lot of people trying different things and different formulations, and you see the whole list of things that, even new chemical entities, and you can use this pathway. And we do have a lot, and PAREXEL does have a lot of experience, dealing with this type of NDAs, and definitely we can sort of support this type of 505B2 at all stages, right from the conception to approval. But I think it's a conversation with the agency becomes a very important part, I specifically worked on projects where we thought we would need a clinical study, and made an argument to the agency not to have that, and they came back and accepted that. So there are certain areas where you need to understand the data. Oftentimes the important point is, what is the modification that you are doing. To get your NDA approval. That is the, because that, if you can define that modification well, FDA wants to see more data on that to support that modification, and then you can bridge the rest of it, whether at the non-clinical space or in the clinical space. So that's the key. And so it is, although, you know, sometimes, you know, I've seen that people come back and say, well, you know, if we do a PK study, and that would be, and it's a PK bridging study. And I think, you know, many of you probably have gone to the agency and also looked at some of the standard templates they use. And it's, and now it's about 2.5 pages they write for each and every 505B2. It's a preamble. And I often work with a lot of ex-US companies, and they don't have much experience, and they go through each line and ask me questions, you know, so what do I do? So it's a very interesting experience. And it's sometimes hard to kind of, tell the story, okay, this is what they mean, and blah, blah. Because one of the things is that, you know, if you are in the 505B2 space and some another 505B2 gets approved, then your 505B2 will immediately be shifted to a J. So that's the danger that sometimes you deal with. But then again, there are other situations where you can avoid that. Yeah.
So could you speak more on how that's a danger?
What is that?
To have your 505B2 become a J. How is that a danger?
So for example, you are developing a particular dosage form, orally disintegrating tablet, for an immediate release approved product, and somebody else bit you on that, then you'll be shifted out to the J. Because
what makes the J dangerous?
Well, you're not a new drug anymore. You don't get, maybe you have done clinical trial and you were hoping for a 3-year exclusivity, and you were, you know, thinking of buying those islands and everything, and nothing will happen. Now you're a generic, you know.
We used to have a conversation within the agency. If it looks and feels like a J, then it must be J.
So two questions. One, have there been any 505B2 biologic NDAs that have been approved to date? A, question one. Question two is, my understanding is the approval across the FDA by different disease areas is various. For instance, the neurology area has been probably the most, done the most, at least when Rusty Katz was there, in terms of approval, and those were kind of the first area where 505B2s were approved. So you showed by formulations, but you didn't show by disease areas. So it seems like the familiarity with 505B2 within the FDA is variable.
Absolutely.
And the experience is variable.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
Can I just?
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you want to move?
No, I don't.
So move to questions.